Spatchcock Nation is in the house. Unfiltered, uncensored, and unapologetically for the people. Turn it up. Spatchcock Nation, welcome to the after party. This is a complimentary episode that goes with binge eating. So we've been talking about binge eating, which is based on binge watching. And now we're going to do some binge talking with my partner in crime in the kitchen, on the couch, all that stuff. My man, Alexander DeRosa.
Partner in crime on the couch. That's an interesting introduction. And you mean within binge watching TV?
Let's just. I mean, any way you want to take that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean,
no, we used to do Zoom calls from the couch where we were both next to each other back in the day. I enjoyed those.
I thought it was some of the OnlyFans we were starting with this, but that works too.
We'll have to link to that.
Definitely, man. Definitely. So, let's talk about this episode, dude. It was fun to shoot and binge watching shows, and we tease each other. I mean, you've never seen some of the greatest shows ever, like The Wire or The Sopranos.
Yes. And that's also, just to be for the record, that's like a very subjective best show ever category that you made up. Now, those shows are great, I'm sure, but there's a lot of other great shows out there.
I think it's widely assumed that those are some of the best shows ever. So, you know, I know, like, because you're probably just watching reruns of WrestleMania 6, like on repeat and everything, you know. So
WrestleMania 5 was actually one of my favorites.
Yeah, it was a good one. Yeah.
No, as of late, Breaking Bad has been one of my favorites, Game of Thrones. There's been like some random Netflix shows that just pop up, like, but they're more of like mini series, like Super Pump, The Story of Uber. There's a Spotify doc I watch. These shows are popping up everywhere. They're not quite they're binge worthy, which means I can get through them in like a day because they're short. But the longer shows, Game of Thrones is one of my favorite.
Same. And there's some great eating in that show too. Like when the Hound is like, I'll take six chickens, like all those eating scenes. But you know, you turned me on to one of my favorite shows, binge watchable for sure, The Bear. And when I think about The Bear, you were talking about the artistic videography of it and the characters. Like, I want to hang out with Richie so bad. And that is a great cooking show. Like, everything about that show is so awesome.
Yeah, no, The Bear is what I strive to be and have us be with Spatchcock someday. The way that they shoot those cooking scenes and then the continuous shot that leads you through the kitchen and show you like what, like a realistic environment in a restaurant is just so cool. And that's why they do that. I mean, they show you like the communication between the kitchen and the restaurant and the wait staff and all that. And it's very cool. And they, you know, the people that work on that are incredible.
And when she's drinking out of like the storage container, plastic cup, right, to drink the water, there's so many small details that are true to the restaurant, but also the way that they're cooking the food. When he talks about how great her risotto is, but it needed, I think it was risotto she was making, but it needed acid, right? And it's just all the stuff that kind of makes sense. And it's one of those things that's great for TV.
Have you ever been locked in a freezer?
You actually put me in a freezer at one point when we were working at a beer fest.
I didn't put you in it. It was an ice cooler and you climbed in it.
All right. Well, I might have been talking to it.
A little bit different than being stuck in a restaurant freezer while your restaurant's full, but
totally on opening night too. Yeah. Yeah.
Voluntary.
Okay. Well, speaking of cool things like chess, we've got one of the coolest guests that we've had all season. And I want to introduce her right now. So first, her name is Mary Ann Esposito. She really doesn't need an introduction, but I'm going to give her one anyways, because she's someone that is kind of like the patron saint of cooking shows. She is the longest running televised chef in the United States. And ironically enough, she didn't start cooking really until her 30s. And then all of a sudden blew up into this awesome thing. But despite being on CNN and working with all these huge stars in Food Network, when you spend time with her, you feel like you're the star of the conversation. She is an incredible person, an incredible cookbook author. One of the books that I've been really digging is Ciao Italia. And this book actually isn't just an awesome cookbook. It talks about gardening. So for our show, right, I got that table planner we got from Robert. We're going to start planting stuff. And I'm always nervous I'm going to ruin the garden. So this book is becoming a Bible coming into the spring for me right now, cooking. So she is super awesome. And we're going to talk to her about television, about cooking, partying, traveling, all the things. Ladies and gentlemen, the great Mary Ann Esposito.
Oh my God, what an introduction. I'm humbled by all of it. Thank you so much. I don't think I'm the patron saint of cooking, but I mean, you know, maybe I'm in the running for that, you know, along the way. There've been so many saints of cooking, But anyways, lovely to be with you two guys. You're always so much fun to watch.
Well, thank you so much. And you know what? About the patron saint thing, I was thinking about this seriously the other day. About as our show has launched, and this is the first season of our TV show. You've been doing it forever. And I thought about your show and other people. Like, to me, if there's a Mount Rushmore right now, maybe of at least for our show and influences, it's going to be like Julia Child, Anthony Bourdain, you. You know, like they're just great shows that have different personalities. So thanks for all you've done for us and everybody in the audience.
Well, that's the whole point of it, isn't it? To bring along the new people and to just see that whole genre grow. Because, of course, you know, when I started, there were no Italian cooking shows. There were very few cooking shows. There was no Food Network. So I feel like I've been a paver, you know, along with Julia and Jacques and Graham Kerr and Martin Yan and all of those people that, you know, came before me, that I was watching them when I was a teenager, never, ever dreaming that I would do something like this. I would have said, you're crazy. I would have choked on two meatballs, but no, here I am. But anyway, it's been a great ride, and I'm wishing you a great ride on your new series. It's a lot of fun to watch. I was watching you make the blonde roux the other day and throwing corn out into the audience someplace.
I will say, Mary Ann, my daughter, who's been on a couple episodes with Matt, on local TV here, she loves watching him throw stuff, and it's like her favorite thing. And we've had other people calling him and like, our kids are throwing stuff in the house because they just see you.
You know, you said something that we want to talk. We're gonna get way. This show is about you and your history and our love for what you're doing and the influence that you've had a bunch of people. So you said something interesting that I think a lot of people don't realize. That there weren't a lot of Italian cooking shows. And a lot of people, especially in the restaurant industry and where we are now in Syracuse, and you grew up in Buffalo, the default setting usually is Italian restaurants because people can find things they want to eat. But it's now one of the most common things that people know how to cook. And I think people originally don't realize it's a hard thing to do to cook really good Italian food. You need the fresh ingredients. But tell us about, well, a bunch of stuff. But one thing I want to know about is, how did you kind of introduce that? Because Italian cooking, something I love to do, it's like French cooking. It has to be done right. So how did you get it? How did you feel like we can talk about Italian cooking to an audience that it's some complicated stuff? How do you make it so easy, or how do you start with that?
Well, first of all, you have to know who your audience is. And, you know, when I started Ciao Italia, first of all, I live in New Hampshire. Now, try to find an Italian in New Hampshire. It's not like Syracuse or Buffalo where they're all there. There are no Italians in New Hampshire. So for me to go to a public TV station and make this hard sell using words like, well, you know, I'm going to do osso buco and risotto alla milanese. What is she talking in a foreign language? What is this? So what I had to do was convince them that at the time that I was making this approach, just like you said, Italian food has always been central to most people's cooking because it's an approachable food. It's, and with all deference to the French is more of a formalized type of cooking. You got to give me that because I always use this analogy. You want to know how to make a bechamel sauce? There is a formula in French cooking. That's the formula you follow. You want to make a tomato sauce for Italian cooking? You go knock on 15 doors in Naples, and every one of them, the little Nona or the mama or whoever, is going to tell you, no, I don't add sugar. No, I put the in the garlic whole. No garlic, only extra virgin olive. So the thing about Italian regional cooking, because that's what my show is about, there is no such thing as Italian cooking. I said that on my first show. I thought they were going to throw apples at me. There's no such thing as Italian cooking. There's only regional cooking because there are 20 regions in Italy. I wouldn't be here 30 years later with this if I knew everything there is to know about Italian regional cooking. It's vast. It's beyond my lifetime and beyond your lifetime because it's born from what was on hand, where you lived, and how you chose to cook with it. There was no written recipe. I remember when I did my first cookbook, Ciao Italia, I called my mother and I said, Mom, I need the recipe for Mrs. Ritchie's cookies. Okay, great. In comes the recipe. Flour, egg, sugar makes one bushel. That's the recipe. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, when you're talking about that, when you first started, tell us, before we can get into your venture into being this prolific cooking show host, as a kid, like, what did you watch on TV? You didn't start really cooking seriously. What's your experience with TV? What did you grow up watching? Because it wasn't cooking shows, I don't think.
No, I grew up watching Julia Child.
Okay.
For sure. I watched Julia Child, you know, she was very mesmerizing.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I cursively watched her. It's not like I had to tune in every day to watch her, but I watched things like, oh my God, not Dancing with the Stars, but trying to think of the name of that show, you know, with the Mickey Mouse things, the ears and all that. American Bandstand.
Yes.
Oh. I love American Bandstand, you know? So yeah, that's what I grew up watching. Today we have so many different things that we can watch, but then it was very limited. So, you know, I Love Lucy, loved watching I Love Lucy. To me, she's the consummate comedian, still is. I was recently down in Disney, and I happened to walk through that building where they'd have all of her videos, and I'm standing there laughing my head off. She's just, especially the episode where she's making bread. This really sung to me because I make a lot of bread. She's trying to get it in the oven, and she'd put too much yeast in the dough. So now all of the dough is billowing outside the edges of the oven. It's hysterical.
And the bread loaf pushes her. I love that episode.
Right. Isn't that funny?
Yeah.
Yeah. So those are the things that I loved to watch, you know, Twilight Zone, things like that. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. When you were watching Julia Child, though, you weren't ever like, I want to be a cook.
No. Because I grew up with three crazy cooks. My grandmother, my Neapolitan grandmother, I lived in her boarding house. So she was cooking all the time. I lived in the summer with my Sicilian grandmother who had her own butcher shop. That's where I learned how to singe chicken feathers. My mother, when she turned 50, decided she's going to become a dietitian. So I'm surrounded by these people cooking food all the time. It was the last thing I wanted to do. Nope. I was going to college. I wanted to be a high school history teacher. And that's what I did.
High school history. Why high school history?
Well, because when I was a kid, I was always fascinated, like, with ancient Egypt, ancient Rome. I know this sounds crazy. I just loved all of that. And you know what? I still think of myself as a teacher, even though now, you know, I've gone to culinary school. I am a teacher. I'm still in a classroom. It's just that it's a bigger classroom. And I'm still teaching history because I'm telling you, okay, here's how you make this recipe. But do you know why this recipe is called this? Do you know where it comes from? Blah, blah, blah. Give you all of the background to the recipe. So it's history, it's culture, it's food, it's technique, it's all those things, but it's a bigger classroom. It's a TV camera.
I love that point, Mary Ann, about the education aspect, because actually that was one of the things we want to talk to you about. But you know, when you're talking, the thing that I think makes you so appealing to so many people, something that we are trying to emulate in our style and voice is different than yours.
Yes.
Is your ability to relate to young people and people that are older, right? People that are grandparents and their actual adult grandchildren and younger. And the reason why I think it's interesting, and I want to hear about how you do that so well, because you have this it weird in a good way. Like someone that watches I Love Lucy and The Twilight Zone, these are different animals, right?
Yeah.
But you enjoy them the same way. So tell us how you're able to connect with people on such a wide range of experiences and ages and stuff.
Because I'm listening to them. It's not about me, it's about them. You know, so I feel very comfortable, as you say, all age groups. I can talk very freely with them. I usually try to start with something that they're interested in. Like I have a gentleman friend, don't tell my husband, but he's into fly fishing. Now, I know zip about fly fishing, but whenever I see him, I go, Jerry, how's the fly fishing? Did you make any ties this week? Where are you going fly fishing? And then that starts the conversation. So I always start with something that I know that is pertinent to that person. Even if it's a young kid, like I remember once we had, I don't know if you know Patsy's in New York City, that very iconic restaurant that Frank Sinatra would go to all the time. Yeah. He's got all the celebrities went to Patsy's. And so Patsy's son made an appearance on my show. He made Madeleines, which are small little cookies. Now this kid was 10 years old. So I'm trying to put him at ease in front of the camera and all of that. And he'd been practicing for 3 days ahead of time to make sure that he didn't make any mistakes. But I found out that he loved baseball. So what did I do? I talked to him about baseball first. And I said, well, now we got to get that pitching arm of yours ready to make these cookies. And that just kind of relaxed him. So it's about the other person. It's not about you.
That's a good life lesson anyway. That's like the teaching side of you though in the classroom, because you know, we talk about that all the time, is like not being a good listener. Me and Matt were having this conversation the other day. Is like, I am trying to get better at remembering people's names. They introduce themselves and I'm like, what?
Yeah.
And I'm like, I didn't even hear it. Why didn't I hear it? And so listening to what they're interested in, because it's not, even in our show, it's, you know, we get a lot of feedback, good and bad all the time. People are always offering advice, which is awesome. Mm-hmm. And for us to make sure we integrate it, one little small thing that's in it, someone saw it, they felt heard, and now they're like, now they're fans for life.
Exactly. Know? Yeah.
Yeah. I just so appreciate that approach, because the educational aspect of it, the thing I think about, and my day job is, as a college professor, when you're educating somebody, if you can make it interesting to them, they no longer feel like they're hearing a lecture or a lesson.
Right.
And I think one of the things that we've tried to learn from you is you're able to talk about some complicated aspects of cooking, because like there's something, I was looking at something that you did a couple of years ago, and you're talking about when you're basically cooking down onions, right? And mm-hmm. what people don't realize, when you're caramelizing onions and the time it takes into that, a lot of people screw that up. And mm-hmm. for people that cook a lot, it's an easy thing to do. And you explained it in a way that kind of mm-hmm. took the pressure off. And mm-hmm. I think that is something that is also rare too, because the complicated stuff, and your willingness to try different things. Like, I know that you, at least from what I've read in your books, you prefer eating peas fresh. Fresh peas. Yeah, I've found four or five recipes where you're cooking peas, you know? So you're willing to try different things, which is awesome.
Yeah. You know, from the get-go, the whole premise of the show, besides being focused on regional cooking, is cooking from scratch. Because people don't realize that cooking from scratch is not hard. And it's better for you. It's not hard. And so I try to make it easy for people. Like, for instance, for peas, you don't even have to cook peas. You know, if you're using, I like peas right out of the garden, just like that. But if, you know, you got a bag of frozen peas, I tell people, well, don't cook those to death. They're partially cooked anyway. Just defrost them, put them in the dish that you're making, and you're good to go. So trying to make cooking seem not like a chore for people is, you know, part of what I do.
You know what the biggest chore, and I cook a lot, my wife cooks a lot, for me is finding the ingredients. I feel like I can never find, or I never have, you know, the mm-hmm. ingredients. So like just having those things around, because you're cooking similar types of dishes and knowing how to use them is important. Even when we do our show, we've learned to keep things on stock, kind of use some of the same ingredients, reference how we used them. I think it's important because that's why things like HelloFresh exist, because people don't want to buy all this ingredient for one recipe, and it's expensive.
Mm-hmm. That's true. And I tell people, you know, if you have three designated areas in your kitchen, you have a pantry in three places. Your refrigerator is your pantry. Your cupboard is your pantry. Your freezer is your pantry. And in all of those three cupboards, you can keep certain things, you know, that can be on hand so that you can just grab and make something. For instance, one of the easiest dishes, we're into Lent, right? Are you guys holy? I hope so. Okay, we're into, at that. I see the halos. So if you have a jar of Italian tuna in your cupboard, you have a jar of Italian tuna, you have olive oil, obviously, there's garlic someplace, right? And there's a bag of pasta. Now you have the makings of a really great dish, because you have a lemon in your refrigerator. And maybe you don't have capers, but that's something you should think about if you're going to cook Italian a lot. And capers and salt can stay forever. So now you can make this fabulous, and I mean fabulous, lemon, pasta, caper, and tuna dish with a little few flecks of hot red pepper. Delicious. And it's ready in what? 15 minutes. Who doesn't have 15 minutes? Come on. Yeah. 15 minutes.
See, that advice is great, because every night the battle, and I think it's not just me, is what are we making for dinner? And we go to the store on Sunday and we buy a bunch of stuff and we come back and we're like, we have nothing to make. Why didn't we buy any dishes to make? And just to have, so we end up, you know, making pasta, right? Yeah. It gets easier, but like, we're like, we need something that is just a go-to dish that's always in the house and that kind of stuff.
You know, and also thinking ahead, like on the weekends, if you're not working, I try to do things that I have that I'll be able to have during the week. You know what? If I'm making a stew, I might make an extra, you know, just make extra, put it in the freezer. Then I have it for another meal. So if you're going to chop an onion once, why can't you chop an onion twice? Because yeah. then you can make double the amount. You can put it in the freezer and then you have it. So thinking like that, I tell people, you know, cooking comes from experience. It comes from experience. It's like a painter. Think of a painter, an artist. He's got a palette of colors, right? And he's got a blank canvas. But the more he mixes those colors and plays with them, he knows exactly what he's going to put on that canvas because he's done it so many times. And believe me, once you start cooking like that, be organized, have a pantry in those three places that I'm telling you about, it's going to be a whole lot simpler. If you have a dozen eggs in the refrigerator, you have a few tomatoes, maybe you have a cucumber in the refrigerator, a half a used pepper. Okay, whip that up, put in some grated cheese. You've got a frittata. Why is that so hard? That's 10 minutes.
I love that. And the meal prep. So I try, like, I'll meal prep meals for my wife. She travels a lot or she's got a lot of stuff going on at work. But that point you made, Mary Ann, about putting stuff in the freezer. The freezer is underrated. And a lot of people that are starting to cook and want to talk, they're like, oh, I'm like, one thing you should buy if they're like, should I get a sous vide? And I love sous vides. And I'm like, you need some good knives, but you need a freezer, right? Yeah. If you're making a Sunday sauce, try to double the batch, throw some in the freezer, whatever it may be. And you know, but you're talking about for starting up cooks. I want to move on to hearing about how the show got started, your show got started in the first place. Like, you've been doing it a long time. I believe someone bought you something and then all of a sudden you're like, you know what? I'm going to become an expert at this. And then obviously the rest is history.
Well, you know, it didn't exactly start out that way. So what happened was my husband's a physician, but he's also the head gardener for Ciao Italia. Because ever since he was in medical school, he's had a garden. No matter where we were, he always had a garden. And I tell you in that cookbook that you just showed a few minutes ago, that Italians, it's in their DNA to have gardens. Our grandparents had gardens, our aunts and uncles had. You go way back, they all had gardens, whether it was on a balcony in Rome in pots, or they had a little plot of land next to the railroad track. They had gardens. So one day in the house came a magazine called Medical Economics, which my husband received. And they were having a contest and it said, send us a story, not medical related. And if we publish it, we'll pay you $250. And I'm looking at this thinking, I'm going, my husband can't write for beans. But so I decided that I would do it under his name, right? Guy Esposito. So I write this story called, I traded my scalpel for a spatula. And this is a story about Guy being in a cooking school in Sorrento, Italy, with a bunch of women, all women. And he's the only guy. And his name is Guy. So I tell this story about, you know, the chef Lorenzo and what we were making and all this. And I made it very funny. And so I sent it in. He doesn't know I sent it in. I sent it in. About a month later comes this letter. You won. So $250 later, Guy says to me, he says, you know, Mary Ann, you might have something here. He says, why don't you try to interest the local PBS station, which I live in a town where we have a PBS station. Why don't you try to interest them in a local cable show? Nothing national, a local cable show. I said, you're crazy. No. So he said, no. Why don't you put together 13 shows, show themes, take it over to them. Okay, I did that. I take it over to them and they're looking at me like glass-eyed, you know. Like I said, there's no Italians in New Hampshire. So thank you very much for coming. Yes, we'll take your proposal into consideration. Goodbye. Okay, go home, right? So I go home and he says, okay, he says, maybe that didn't fly. Why don't you try teaching adult ed classes at the local high school? So I thought, you know, maybe that's an idea. Okay, so I did. I would, and this was a labor of love, believe me, because it was all on you. You had to think up the show, the classes. You had to go get all the ingredients, bring them home, prep them, put them in your car, lug them over to the school, go up a whole flight of stairs, undo them, put them on the counter, teach the class, then go home, unload, and do this whole thing.
And that was before Instacart. You didn't have Instacart delivering.
Oh my God, no.
So were you teaching at the same time? You were doing both? Like, you were doing this after your high school history teaching job?
I was doing this after my high school history job. Yeah. So not only that, but I had a catering business. So this all kind of played together. I was going to the university, getting my master's degree. Oh, I was everywhere. So, okay. I getting ready to do the next adult ed class. And comes this letter, and it's from the PBS station. Well, we've moved into a new building now. We have a new studio, and we'd like to do a pilot program in your kitchen. Okay. I have no idea what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. I don't know what pilot program means. I'm like, oh, that's great. So on a hot summer day in August, I remember the theme of this was al fresco. It was going to be an Italian picnic. And they show up with a big mixer truck outside my house and a crew of about 25 people come in, stop all the clocks, the air conditioning, unplug the refrigerator, slap makeup on you, you know, gel the windows, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, talk. Oh my God. I thought, at that point, I had to just pretend they were not there. And I think that is the thing that saved me all these years, is that I just looked at that camera coming at me and I thought, okay, it's a person, it's a person. This is in my mind, it's a person. And I just went for it. And as if I was just talking to you guys, you know, you were sitting across the kitchen table from me. This took from 8 o'clock in the morning till 6 o'clock at night to get 26 minutes of episodic information. Okay. Guy is off in the hospital somewhere doing rounds, right? He comes home, he goes, well, how was the TV show? I said, Guy, I'm not doing this. It's too mental. It's too physical. No, 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 no. Okay. So they said hello and goodbye, took the thing with them. And they said, well, we're going to send this out to review to see what kind of reaction it gets. Well, here's the kicker. At that point, now this is 1989. Think about this. What is happening in the U.S. with food in 1989? Matt.
I'm glad Alex. You posed that to him. No, you already posed it to Matt. Matt's got to answer you.
Okay, Matt's got to see, huh? Easy way out. Okay.
Well, in 1989, you had a couple things. The really massive processed foods are being forced on everybody. That became a really big deal.
Yes, we're getting close.
Okay.
EVOO.
Where people start using extra virgin olive oil. Actually, Alex gets mad when I say EVOO, but that's
I know. I don't like it either. That was the time when all of a sudden, all this information's out there about the Mediterranean diet. Hey, people on the Mediterranean diet live longer? And why is that? They're eating a lot of vegetables, number one, and their cooking fat is extra virgin olive oil. So, okay, this plays right into where I am, right? So they send out these episodes and yeah, we're going to do this show. Now we got to find funding. You know how PBS is, right? That's always the thing. So they go out, they find funding from King Arthur Flower. That was our first underwriter, King Arthur Flower. And we did 13 shows. They built me a kitchen studio. And, you know, I would hate to see those first two series because I think I improved after that. But they knew nothing about cooking shows. I mean, they knew nothing about, how to produce a cooking show. But I knew everything I could know about food and how to cook it. So we were kind of evenly matched. I didn't know what they were doing. They didn't know what I was doing. And here's what they would do. In those early days, in the first or second season, we'd have practice episodes. So they'd call me into the studio ahead of the real, you know, production. And they'd say, okay, what are you going to do today? I'm going to make pizza rustica. Okay. So I would sit there and I would do all this stuff and they would be there with timers, you know, okay, well, we're going to have to cut that part out. Can you have a double of this or that? That's when you learned about swap outs, right? You know what swap outs are.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. We all know what swap outs are. Okay. So this went on for the first two seasons. The first season was local. It just went around, you know, around in the area. Second season, PBS gets wind of this. And they say, we're going to pick this up. So I remember the CEO of the station coming down to me in the kitchen and she's saying, oh my God, PBS just picked up this show. I am so jazzed. I remember when she said that. I'm just so jazzed. So from then on in, you know, it was on PBS and there it is till this day.
What was the, besides the idea of 20 people roaming around and probably over your shoulder and pointing cameras every which way, what was the other hardest, like what was the hardest thing to get used to?
The hardest thing to get used to was to try to have to read off of a teleprompter. I do not do that. Either you know what you're doing or you don't. I cannot read and cook at the same time. Mm-hmm. So for me, it's like being a teacher. If you're teaching a subject, you damn well better know your subject and not be just one page ahead of the kids who are reading about the destruction of the Roman Empire, right? I knew my subject. I knew my subject. And therein was the familiarity and the comfortability of doing this in front of a camera. So that's what, that's been my mantra ever since. You know, you are talking to me, I'm talking to you, and we're just having a good old time. But what the viewer doesn't know is, besides you having to know your subject, you have to know all this TV lingo. Like when I started out, they would say things like, okay, when you go to the refrigerator, don't talk. Get the ingredients, take 5 steps, put the ingredient on the table, and look at camera 2. All the while, you have to, after the 5 seconds are up, you have to start talking. But then you have to remember what they all told you to do. But it's seamless. I'm just talking to you, but in my head, I know I got to go over there in 5 seconds, put this over here. That was hard to get used to. But I did get used to it, so much so that in one episode, I was doing truffles because I had just been in Italy. So I wanted to show people how to use, and we had black truffles from the Urbani company in New York, Long Island. They sent them to us. Okay, so we're going to do black truffles, right? So we walk through this. We call the walkthrough. So the cameras know where you're going. Put the truffles in the refrigerator, then come back to the counter, introduce the thing, then go back, get the truffles, don't talk. 5 seconds later, start talking. All right. Okay, so 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, we're going, right? Go to the refrigerator. I get the truffles. I bring the truffles back, wait the 5 seconds, and then I start talking. And I hear, stop, 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 stop. Okay. What? Did I swear? What did I do wrong? Go back to the refrigerator. I went back to the refrigerator. I opened the refrigerator door. And I am not kidding you. Sitting on the shelf is a mannequin head this big that I never saw. I never saw it because I was in the zone.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what that means.
Were they playing a trick on you?
They were trying to get, they were playing a trick on me. I went, I never saw it. And so I blew their bubble. You know, this thing was huge. I still have it. It's sitting in my bathroom. This big, huge mannequin head is right there.
Oh, my God. That's crazy.
I know. But that's what happens. See, once you know when you're in the zone, the two of you know when you're in, because all of a sudden you've hit your stride. You're in that horse race and you're just going and nothing's going to stop you. And you're just going and you know it's going well because, you know, you were in that stride.
Yeah.
You know it's going well, you know.
Yeah.
But, oh, my God, that's when I realized this is serious.
That is so awesome. And you know what, the being in the stride thing, I want to ask you about something that I read about. And the thing is you, and you have this great aura about you and you're sweet and people love being around you, but you're also a pretty intelligent business leader. And I know you work with your son, Chris and Guy a lot, but I've read it in multiple places that when you are doing one of your cookbooks, you somehow have an army of like 20 people in the kitchen at the same time, making different recipes.
Yeah.
Tell us about how do you manage all the moving parts? Like, I know people would, I mean, I'd love to be one of those volunteers and see how you do that. So walk us through that mayhem of a day of making all the stuff for your cooking books.
Yeah. So, with PBS in the beginning, you used to have a premium, right? So the premium was a cookbook. So now we're at cookbook number 14, but you always needed a premium, a cookbook. So I test everything and I write all those recipes. I don't have any ghostwriters writing these things. It's me because these are my experiences. But I do have a team of women, and not 20 women, 3 women. And I'll say to them, tomorrow we are going to make torta pasqualina, but I need 3 swap outs because I have to show them how to make the pasqualina. We have to have a baked pasqualina, and then we have to have a pasqualina that we're going to cook for the present, the end of the program where we say, today we made torta pasqualina. Okay. I can tell you that we normally would go through, whenever we're dealing with doughs, I'll use that as an example. It was not unusual for us to go through 50 pounds of dough, of flour, in one episode, because we had to think about
what,
you know, the swap outs. That's the magic word. And okay, we're going to put this in the oven. We don't have 30 minutes to wait, right? Here it is. But I would sit down with them after we did every episode at the end of the day. We work like fools. And we would talk about the next day and what we needed and how we were going to execute it. And these women were just so dedicated to what I was doing that they would have done anything for me. And they learned how to make different kinds of pastas. In fact, on one show, which took us, this was the afternoon show, we usually did three shows a day, if you can imagine this. We did three shows a day. Yes, usually three recipes in each show. Think about that. We now have over 800 recipes on our website. And then at the end of the day, we cooked an entire meal from scratch for the board of trustees in the studio after we got done. We set it up like an Italian piazza, beautiful dishes and everything. And these people ate in courses like Italians do. And when I think back on those days, I think, how the heck did we do that? We were exhausted. You know, you're mentally tired at the end, right?
Are you ever doing back-to-back days? Like, is it one day and then you...
would be every day. Every day.
Because that's the thing, like mentally, like, so we'll shoot four recipes in a day.
That go into
one episode, but it's just a portion of the episode that we shoot. Right.
Yeah.
But mentally, by the end, and we've done a good job of trying to find ways to liven it, but like, you're drained to figure out what you want to say and the jokes and the stories. Everything is just not as strong. How did you manage that with nine?
You just do. I mean, you know, the adrenaline is running. And you know that time is money, because this is PBS. This is not, you know, we don't have the luxury of having some big corporation sponsoring us, right?
Yeah.
We have to. Our team has to go out and find those bucks every year for the series. So you got to use that money wisely. And so we were making use of all the time that we have, making it very succinct. We got to have fun. It's got to look like it's fresh and all of that. Mm-hmm. But it is a labor of love, as you well know.
You know, when you're speaking about love, and we want to ask you about this, because when you were here at that awesome event, your menu was great.
Yeah,
I got to sit and watch that awesome live demo you did. And I loved how you teased and how you regularly reference your husband, Guy. And we know he's a wine educator, and this dude's a surgeon.
Yeah.
And our wives are part of our show. They appear regularly. They actually write some cool part to it. Tell us about the love story between you and your husband. How did that go down? Because it's so cool seeing you interact together. You make a joke and he's rolling his eyes walking around. Tell us that whole story.
Well, see, I'm the extrovert and he's the introvert. So the love story started in my sophomore yearbook where he wrote, "Good luck, you need it." That came back to haunt him. The thing is, I think for a marriage to survive, you have to have some common interests, not all. So we have parallel common interests. Yes, he's a surgeon on one end, but on the other hand, he's a gardener. He's a wine expert. He can cook. He loves food. He loves to ask me questions. So, you know, we're in that world together. So we can explore that world and we can have fun with it. And it brings us closer together. That's how that works. So now when I take my tours to Italy, which I've done now for the last 20 years, you guys need to come sometime. You have the station pay for it. I'll let them know.
Oh, of course.
So every year I take a group to Italy. I've been going now twice a year, and I take a small group, maybe 20 people. And I work with a very small company in Philadelphia. And I always choose a different region of Italy. So when I decide what I'm going to do, where I'm going to go, I tell Guy, here's what I'm cooking. And I need you to pair the appropriate wines for these dishes, the regional wines of the area. So that's what he'll do. And when we get to Italy, the first thing these people get is a wine seminar with Guy. And he teaches them the five S's of wine. We call it class in a glass with the wine guy. And so this introduces people to the ABCs of wine. And then on the tour course, they get to cook with me, hands-on cooking. They use the indigenous ingredients of the region. They cook in a cooking class with me. And Guy pairs the wines for those foods. And then we will take additional food related trips to, like, well, let's see how Gorgonzola cheese is made. Let's go to this Enoteca to in the winery. Let's go to Altamura to see how they make pane Altamura. So they're exposed to all these foods and they're seeing how these foods are made in Italy. They know what DOP means because we expose them to these kinds of things. And so there's a reverence for Italian foods that don't exist in our country because of the control, the quality control that is put on them. So yeah, it's just a lot of fun.
I love that you include your husband in this because I think, you know, something that I don't think a lot of food shows, you know, there's a good amount, but there's some food shows that don't include storytelling in there. Personal experiences is why, like, everything in our show, our wives, our friend groups, it's all integrated in it because that's our personal experience. And we want people to see us and say, that's my friend group, or I can see myself in their group, or they seem authentic and approachable. And how important is storytelling in your brand, in your life, and your experience to bring Guy into this, you know?
Storytelling is everything, you know? I mean, whether I'm telling a story about Guy or our kids or my grandmothers or my mother, people always find those kinds of things fascinating. Like, for instance, when we were in Sicily, I told the story of my Sicilian grandmother making an appeal to St. Joseph. Now, on March 19th is the Feast of St. Joseph, and he is the patron of pastry chefs. I didn't know if you knew that. So, but it turned out that St. Joseph is very revered in Sicily. And on March 19th, they pull out all the stops, like my grandmother did. But they make what are called le tavole di San Giuseppe, the tables of St. Joseph. So what these are altars. St. Joseph's in the center, flowers everywhere, and then 100 different dishes, Lenten dishes, because his feast day is in Lent, so you can't have meat. 100 Lenten dishes that are enjoyed by anyone in Sicily who wants to do an altar. They open their doors to the public. I've been in many of them. You go in, you're there with complete strangers, and you're enjoying these Lenten dishes from fava beans, God knows what, zeppole. Well, anyway, so my grandmother, my Sicilian grandmother, tells the story of my grandfather, her husband, which was an arranged marriage. And he had tuberculosis. And so she went to the church, the Chiesa Madre in Sicily, in her town of near Caltanissetta. And she looks at the altar from the back of the church. And she says, you have to cure my husband. And to make a pact, I'm going to get down on my knees now and roll my tongue on the wood floor. You know, think about splinters and all this. I'm going to roll my tongue all the way to the altar, which she did. I'm listening to this story. I'm thinking, oh, my God, you know, and yeah, my grandfather, for whatever reason, whether that worked or not, was cured. But and when I tell stories like that, people get, I mean, they get goosebumps. You know, they think, oh, my God, these are like superstitious things. And in many ways they are, because, you know, let's take the malocchia. You know the malocchia? You know the horn that you find when you go to Sicily or Naples, the horn, that the red horn that people are wearing around their neck. Why is that there? You see those everywhere. They're there because you wear that, you're going to be protected. No matter what, the devil's not going to get to you. You're going to be protected. And my father always wore this. And he told me the story of when he had a really bad cold that was going to go into pneumonia. My grandmother says, come here. So she gets out a big bowl of soup, and then she takes a drop of olive oil and she puts it in the center. Now, if that olive oil had spread out, this is bad news. But if it stayed in the center as a circle, you're good to go. And those are things associated with, you know, Italian life that are precious, because, you know, and I remember them, you know. I'm glad they told me these stories. It's kind of, it's like going on that show, you know, Finding Your Roots. Yeah. And they go, oh my God, no, really?
So, you know, I love that you share that, because that's, and I got goosebumps on that story too. Yeah. And, you know, and by the way, I was born in St. Joe's Hospital, so hopefully that counts.
Oh, that counts. Yes.
You were talking about wine, and I think I remember the five S's. I know it's see, swirl, sniff. I think sip might be one of them.
Yes. See, swirl, sniff, smell, and savor.
Okay. Savor.
Yeah.
So when you're talking about the Italian traditions and all the time you've spent there, what I've been doing recently, you know, you're trying to learn and improve your skill set. So I've been spending a lot of time studying a lot of French cooking, a lot of Julia Child and Bourdain, and a lot of the wine pairing with that.
Yeah.
And experimenting with that, getting the taste and how things work. And in Italian cooking, I've been, you know, I love that too. And I'm learning about that. But the way that wine is treated in both of those styles is almost like a religious experience in the pairing of it. So tell me about that. Like when you're with Guy, or you're either having dinner at home or having people over, how are you picking the wines? Are there stories associated with that? Like what should a listener or a viewer today be like, okay, she said I should pair wines like this. How do you go about that?
Well, first of all, I'm not a wine expert. I know where the wines of Italy come from. If you ask me, you know, about a certain wine, let's say a Primitivo, I know that comes from Puglia. If you ask me about a Piemontese wine, I can tell you about a Piemontese wine. But if I'm having let's say I'm just having a dinner party, I say to Guy, here's what I'm serving. I'm making Assobuco. What wine are we going to pair with this? And he will tell me. He will tell me which wines he's going to pair. And he goes down to his little wine cellar. He brings up the bottle. He does a little taste. Some of those things down there are so old. But he does a little taste and he'll say, I think this will go good with it. Because you need to know, first of all, how does Assobuco taste in your mind, right?
Yeah.
You need to know that ahead of time. It's not like you're going to make it and then you're going to taste it. You need to know. Like a risotto. What kind of a wine would you pair with a risotto a la Milanese? I know what I would pair with it. I would pair an Arnaise with it. Because I love Arnaise, and I think it's a very crisp, clean, white wine. Love it. It's a Piemontese wine. Delicious. But if I were making like a Sunday sauce, I want a really gutsy red wine. A bold wine. A cherry wine. Yeah. Lots of fruit flavor. And those are the things that I defer to Guy about, to ask him those questions. So I'll tell you the story of how he learned how to do all of this. So, he decides he's going to go to Miami and they immerse himself in this immersion course where before you get there, they send you all these books on wines of the world, you know, sake, all this stuff. You got to learn all this stuff before you even go. Then you go to Miami and you shut yourself up in a hotel room for 2 weeks and you study from 6 a.m. till 8 p.m. because you're going to have to pass the test. You're going to have to pass the written test and you're going to have to pass a blind tasting test, right?
Wow. Okay.
So in the middle of this immersion, I decided to just give him a call, see how he's doing, right? Down in Miami. Now, his hotel room is like you walk out the door and there's the beach, right? Okay. So I call. Hi. How's it going? I can't talk now. I'm studying. Slam. Okay. Slam. All righty. We get home. I said, well, did you enjoy the beach? He says, you know, I never set foot on it because I was studying the whole time. We waited and waited because now the exam's over. You did your blind tasting. You don't know how you did because it's going to come in the mail that you either passed or you didn't pass. So those next few weeks, just waiting, you know, the anticipation of it was just enough to drive you crazy. Finally, I go to the mailbox, right? I see this envelope. I'm going, oh, brother. So I bring it in. I said, I think the wine thing came.
Oh, no. Now the pressure's on.
Yeah. So I give it to him. He opens it up. He's got this stoic look on his face. I thought, oh, jeez. He failed. He said, no, I passed. I went, oh my God, you passed. Now you're a level 2 sommelier. Oh my God. But he, you know, he loves to just get people interested in thinking about wine. And he wants to dispel this whole thing about, well, I think I taste leather. No, you know, maybe chocolate, strawberries, pears, apples, you know, those things are all there, but they shouldn't become the focus of it. What he tells people is any wine that you like to drink is your favorite wine, and you can cook with that wine too, right? You don't have to go out and buy cooking wines. So he tries to take the mystery of it out, make it easy, you know, because wine does have that standoffish, oh my God, wine, that's a complicated thing. And wine is a complicated thing, but you don't have to be so uptight about it. And I think that's the thing that he's good at.
You know, Alex, just real quick, I wanted to add something to that, because Marianne, I'm pairing, having different wines, but it's more about what you like. But you just said that so well, and it makes me think, and Alex, I think you can agree with this. Can you imagine how awesome it would be to have a dinner party at Marianne and Guy's house? Like, oh my God, she's going to learn what you're interested in, talk to you about these things, make incredible food. My man's a level 2 sommelier pairing you with stuff like,
yeah.
I heard Sunday sauce and my mouth was watering. I'm like, I love Sunday sauce.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know why it's called Sunday sauce? Why is it called Sunday sauce? See, that's another story. It's called Sunday sauce because on Sunday morning in the past, you were going to church, right? So your mom and your grandmothers, they had to make the sauce. And so the sauce had, it had spare ribs, it had sausages, it had meatballs, it had chicken necks. Now, all those meats take time to cook, right? So you would put this all in the pot, get the sauce in there, you would go to church. By the time you came back from church, Sunday sauce was ready. And that's why it was called Sunday sauce. That's where the name came from. And see, those are the little things that you can explain to people that really make an impact as to what they're doing. And why is it this? Why is it called this? You know, like I actually just had a chef over for dinner the other night, and I made something called aquapazza. And aquapazza is a dish, translates to crazy water. And what it is it's a fish dish. It's a Neapolitan fish dish that was beloved by sailors. And what they would do is when they were out at sea getting fish, they would cook on board, right? So they would cook the fish with wine and with other things that they had. Maybe they had a few tomatoes, maybe they had some little red peppers or something. And because they added wine to it and a little bit of hotness, they called it crazy water, aquapazza. And it's absolutely delicious. So easy to do. You can find the recipe on the Ciao Italia website. Very simple, but very delicious. Try it sometime. It has fennel in it and little cherry tomatoes, wine, capers. Delicious.
I just made a note to try it. Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So you, we promised you a video. I'm really excited about this video now because... not that I wasn't before and I knew you would like it, but now that it's come up in conversation, I'm even more excited to get your take on it. But we're going to watch this and then I have a follow-up question for you.
Okay.
Hello, friends. I'm your Vitamita Benjamin girl. Are you tired, run down, listless? Do you poop out at parties? Are you unpopular? The answer to all your problems is in this little bottle.
Now you pick up the bottle.
Oh.
A little higher. That's right.
The answer to all your problems is in this little bottle. Vitamita Benjamin. Vitamita Benjamin contains vitamins, meat, vegetables, and minerals. Yes, with Vitamita Benjamin, you can spoon your way to health. All you do is take a tablespoonful after every meal.
Now you take some.
Oh. It's so tasty, too. It's just like candy.
No. Look, you're supposed to like the stuff. You've got to smile, be happy. Yes. Now try it again.
Yes, sir. so tasty, too. Just like candy.
Nope, once more.
So, based on, you know, I'm thinking we've had the luxury in the early days of this to just be me and Matt in the garage making what we like. There's no, you know, and we're editing it after, but hearing your story about like 20 people rolling in your house and just setting up teleprompters and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Have you ever, you know, had something one that they wanted you to make? They're like, we really want you to make this, that you're like, I can't taste it. I can't do this. Or have you ever tried something on screen that was just not good and you reacted in a similar fashion?
I can't say that I have, you know, because I'm the creator of the shows. I get to tell you what we're going to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, they don't have any basis for knowing any of this stuff. Right. So I say, here's what we're going to make, blah, blah, blah. And for my show, when people ask me, well, what do people want from your show? Here's what they want. They want something that is easy to make. They want something that tastes good. They want something that's really Italian, and they want to be able to get the ingredients locally. That's what they want. That's who my audience is. So I'm not going to do octopus because nobody's going to eat it, right? They're not going to eat octopus. Black squid ink? Nope, they don't like that either. Liver and onions? Typical Venetian dish, liver and onions with raisins? Nope, they're not going to eat that. So what do? You stay true to form. You think about those authentic Italian recipes. Mainly you're thinking about the South because you know where most of these immigrant families came from originally, and their descendants are mostly Southern Italians. This is why most people think that Italian food is a red sauce-based food because of where we've come from in the past, right? Where we settled, Philadelphia, New Orleans, New York City. These immigrants, where did they come from? They didn't come from Northern Italy. No, they came from Southern Italy. And they brought those ideas, those cooking ideas with them. And when they could get the ingredients, they made things the way they were made in the old country. So yes, I tried to do things that are familiar with people, but I also like to introduce them to some new things. Like for instance, have you ever tried making a torta pasqualina? Do you know what that is? That's an Easter pie. It has 33 layers. I don't expect you to do this. But in the past, it had 33 layers. Why did it have 33 layers of pastry? Think, it's Easter. Because Jesus was 33 years old.
When he crucified.
Exactly. Yeah. So people are intrigued by something like that. Yeah, show us how to do it. I can show you how to do it. And I'll bet you, that of the 1.6 million people who watch Ciao Italia in each episode, maybe 5 people will make that because they're mesmerized by the process and it's a nice story to think about, but they're never going to make it. You know, they're never going to make it. So you want to make things that people say, oh God, I can't wait to make that. It's so simple. I can't wait to make it. I get emails like that. I made this or I made that. It was great. I'm going to do it again. Yeah.
When you that story is awesome. So I want to party up and talk about a dinner party, but I want to get another story from you. And I'm going to start with you're touching on one of the things that I love about Italian cooking, which you are just doing so great at giving me goosebumps about this, is the storytelling and what it's tied to. But I love, and this is where we're getting into it, is the pride that Italian humans have for sharing their food and talking about it. So a number of years ago, my mother-in-law had some friends over, and they invited my wife and I to go and hang out. So I had some glasses of wine, and there was a gentleman there, and he passed away. May he rest in peace. But he was in his 70s at the time. And this was 15 years ago, maybe a little shorter than that. So, but this man is a truly brilliant cook. Mm-hmm. So we're hanging out, and we're doing some cooking together. And he's like, all right, kid, like you kind of know what you're doing. So I'm like, well, look, man, I'd love to learn this sauce that you make, and I want to make an eggplant rollatini. So we made some of it together, and he wrote down his recipe. Mm-hmm. And he's like, look, I'm not going to cheat on you. And I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, I'm not going to leave something out. I'm going to give you exactly how I do it, which I thought that was cool. And he goes, let's see how you do. So I go home, I make it, I give it to them later on, and he tries it, and he's like, it's pretty good. And I'm like, You're damn right it's good. Like, I crushed this thing. And I didn't adjust anything. I listened to what he did. So he eats it, and he's like, you know, yeah, it's almost exactly how it should be. And I'm like, what do you mean almost? And he goes, you'll never be able to make it the right way. And I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, you weren't born in Italy, and you don't have Italian blood in you. So he's like, this is as good as you're ever going to get. And I was like, what? So when you have people that are learning from you, and they're talking about the Italian, the stories like you do it, tell me some of like a story about that, right? Like how like someone sharing a recipe with you and they're like, well, it's technically my mom's, you'll never get it right, you're not using the right tomatoes. What's the way that you share that Italian pride and inclusiveness while still keeping it real?
Well, what I tell people is this. First of all, what you said is absolutely true. You would never be able to make it the way your friend made it, your 70-year-old friend made, because you made it. He made his. And you can use the same exact ingredients, do the technique, but it'll always be different because it's you. It's not him. And I tell people this in my cookbooks too, that look, these recipes approximate, I like that word, they approximate what this would taste like in Italy. It will never be exact, but it will come close. And the reason it won't be exact is because you're not in Italy using the ingredients from there. You're using ingredients from here. And yes, there are certain elements that you can get that are exact, like San Marzano tomatoes, the wines, the cheeses, some of the salumi, those kinds of things. Yes, the pastas. You can get those things, but the fresh ingredients, you can't. The fish is different. The broccoli's different. The rape's different. So you can approximate. You'll come close, but you will never duplicate. I will never duplicate. Nobody will ever duplicate because you have to be there. So I tell people, as long as you are true to using very good ingredients, as many authentic ingredients as you can in a dish, don't worry. Enjoy. So it's not a competition.
Right. It's the true.
It's a fact that you got people in the kitchen to cook from scratch. See, this, I feel bad for the young generations today because they don't know their food culture. Even in Italy, this is happening with the younger generation. Because when those nonnas and the mothers pass on, there is nobody to ask how to do this. And that's why I think I feel fortunate that I've been able to do this to save a lot of these authentic Italian recipes. I feel very proud of that. They're on our website. You want to know how to make a sofione from Abruzzo? I've got it. What? You ask somebody young in Abruzzo, what's a sofione? They have no idea. They have no idea. It's like kids in this country. They see fish in a package. All they see is a little fillet. They've never seen a fish, right? When you go to Italy and you order fish, what do you get? The head, the eyes, and the tail. Yeah. That's a fish. So we have a long way to go to appreciate our own food culture in this country. And because we are always on a mission to get to the next thing, we don't have that reverence at the table that Italians have. Because believe me, I warn people, you're going to Italy, be prepared to sit for hours, because the discussion will be about you, about your friends, what's going on in the world, but the focus is going to be the food. And if it's artichoke season, they're going to spend an hour talking to you about artichokes, where the best ones come from Italy, how you prepare them, what you add as a stuffing, here's how they do it in Genoa. Yeah, you're there for hours. We do that here? Do we do that here? No, we eat a piece of pizza from a box in front of the TV. That's
and you're out of these restaurants within 30 minutes.
All right. I mean,
that's what we, you know, in our show, it's like this family dinner, this idea of family dinner, which no one does anymore. And it's hard to do with my family and kids.
Yeah.
They're just
you're on a schedule.
Yeah. And so like this idea of it's holidays, right? You get together with your family on the holidays, but then life goes by and you don't see anybody. Our show is all about creating those moments and those times to get together. And so this binge eating episode is, you know, people, it's, you know, yes, it's in front of the TV, but it's like giving a weekly time to get together, to watch,
to be together. Yeah.
To be together. And the idea of the food behind it. And so when you're, if you're, you know, getting together with friends, watching a show, you know, Italian aside, any food, what would be your top choices? And these are like finger foods.
Oh, quick food.
What would you bring to this party?
First of all, I started out with roasted chickpeas. I can see I got a rise out of the two of you.
Yeah. Love that. My wife, that's one of my wife's favorite things in the world. And I never make it enough. Brilliant.
Yeah, I love them. You know, they're very nutty. And the second thing when they're in season is I love raw fava beans with chips of pecorino cheese. See, the thing is about these snacks, you can feel good about them because they're good for you, right? So one of my favorite things to do when company comes is I make these. It's you have one ingredient. I tell people this. I put this on our Instagram thing. One ingredient, Parmesan cheese. What do you do with it? Yeah, you can eat a little piece of it. That's great. But have you ever thought about just grating it and then get out a bake sheet with a piece of parchment paper over the top and put some rounds of grated cheese, let it go in the oven 350 till it's very melty. Take it out, let it sit there. It's now like this little delicious Parmesan wafer. Sometimes I add almonds to it. That's the second ingredient, but you only need one. And people love them. It's the simplest thing in the world. They're going, well, how do you make these? Oh, geez. It's a no-brainer. You know, how do you make these? Yeah. No, things like that. Those are the kinds of things. I mean, we don't really snack on potato chips and, you know, stuff like that. Nuts we do. We have a lot of nuts, but I would say mainly things like the Parmesan wedges or the chickpeas. You know, those are the things that we like.
We made though that exact thing with the Parmesan crisps. We've made them for friends. We made them on the show in this.
Aren't they great?
And they're super easy, and people don't realize how incredibly easy they are. Instead, they're going to buy them pre-made in the store for like $9 for a small tub of them. Crazy. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
What the chickpeas? My wife makes this thing. It's like a vodka sauce with chickpeas, and you fry it on the stove. It's like the best little dish. She made it one time. I was like, oh, I don't want that. And then I tried it, and it's just a simple thing. It's without having to have pasta and stuff. You're just eating. Yeah. It's like a good side dish or regular. Yeah. It was so good.
One of the other things that we like to do is whenever I'm making pizza dough, my daughter is especially fond of this. I save a small piece and then I make the pizza frit the way that my mother did it, which was, you know, you take some of the pizza dough, you let it rise a little bit and you drop it into hot peanut oil and let it puff up. And then she's got the bag of cinnamon, nutmeg and sugar all ready to go. Shake it in the bag. And you just, you know, you got, those are the things you got to eat right out of the pot, you know?
Yeah.
So, and that's a great, like, comfort food. Just love that. So that's really good.
So as far as you said some shows that you watch, but I apologize, I don't know if you have, but have been on a cooking competition. Now all these shows exist, Guys Grocery Games, Chop, they have the you know, all of them. Have you ever considered being on one of those, or have you been on one of those?
I haven't been on one of those, but I judged Bobby Flay's lasagna when he was here in Boston. He didn't win, but
was it Beat Bobby Flay?
Huh?
Was it on his Beat Bobby Flay show, or was
it was on a Beat Bobby Flay show? Yeah, and it was filmed here in Boston, but his lasagna did not win. Yeah,
which is rare. He always wins.
I know. He always wins. Yeah,
he's absolutely brilliant at what he does.
He really is, you know. But he didn't win on that one.
I love how like someone will be like from Italy, or like I watched one the other day where someone was from Taiwan and they were making this dish that was unique to their family. And he didn't know what it was. And he's like, okay. And then still delivered it.
Those shows were wild to me, how they make that stuff.
I've judged them, and I've judged them even from my high school when I did a fundraiser for them. They did a version of Chop. But the one I do remember is at Mohegan Sun Casino with Robert Irvine. That was fun. When we were up there, we had a little competition up there, but you know, it was nothing major, but yeah. And he's a great chef.
It was so stressful. And I know that, you know, it's a TV show. I get that there's behind the scenes and there's stuff that they probably have time to prep, but like in the moment, it's just watching them do this and they're in their zone. They're not even
in their zone, but you know, I'm not one of those cooks that likes to cook with a timer at my head, you know, because of what I do and the culture that I come from. food is more of a meditation than it is a competition. So, you know, when I'm with Italian women in Italy, I'm like, I'm in the grocery store, I'm in the market. And I said, there's a sign. There's always a sign over the produce. It says, non toccare. And that means do not touch. So you never touch the produce in Italy. You call the signora over and you tell her, I want pears. She's gonna say to you, well, what are you gonna do with the pear? Well, I'm gonna make a tart. Okay, let me show you the pears we have for tarts. When was the last time you were in the grocery store and somebody in the grocery store produce department came up and helped you find pears that, does that happen here? No.
Never.
But this is what I'm trying to stress. What kind of pear? Okay, now you want to make, so you want a pera dura. You want a durable pear, something that's going to hold up in baking. So you want this pear. Yeah, and you're listening to this and it's like, a litany of why or why not you should use this particular pear. It's that joy that they bring to the foods that they're showcasing, you know. Even with the little bread makers, you go and you watch them make bread and they're just, it's a meditation. What can I say? It's so I'm not the kind of cook that's got to, oh my God, I got to make this in 2 minutes, you know. No, I don't cook.
You say that, but you've got 24:36 to hit on your show every time, so.
Well, yeah, that's right. And that's I usually do come within the, you know, that I do usually make the mark, but.
That's been one of the hardest things for us to, you know, obviously we did 3.5 minute segments before.
Yeah.
But it's like, we want to tell stories and we want to do all this and 24 minutes goes by so quick.
Very quickly. See, that's the thing about cooking shows is it's like a horse race. The horse is practicing all the time, running, running, running. When he gets to the race, it's over in a flash, right? Mm-hmm. This is the same thing with cooking shows. Everything is the preparation. That's what takes the time. Yeah. Doing the show, that's the after effect. It's gone. It's over in 26 minutes. And for our show, we only do one take. That's it. Because as I said to you, time is money. And it's a continuous take. Unless you've made a really bad blooper, you are going for 24 minutes nonstop. There are no stop and goes because the producer realizes that that takes a certain amount of creativity and energy away from you. Because once you're in that zone, you're there and let it go. Just let it go. And what I love about my producer is my producer used to produce Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. So you can imagine we're kind of like, you know, he's having fun with me. And he told me, he said, Marianne, just do what you want to do. So I do. I just, you know, it's as if I'm just do what I do.
I wish my producer did that.
I'll talk to him.
Oh, man. Okay. So, Marianne, what we're going to do now is we're going to move into a lightning round.
Oh,
so we're going to ask you 6 questions. Oh. That, 2 options. You got to pick one and explain why. You ready?
Yeah.
Okay. The first one. You have to pick between one of these two, Tony Bennett or Frank Sinatra.
Tony Bennett.
Okay. Why?
Because he lived so long.
He did live long.
I know.
Awesome.
I know. I thought he was just he was a great crooner. So was Frank Sinatra. But I liked the gentleness of Tony Bennett. Frank was a little bit more, you know, shall I say, on the other side.
Well, yeah, I get it.
You know what I mean.
I do.
Okay, so you can only cook with one of these ingredients. Mm-hmm. Not just in one dish, but just permanently. Peppers or onions?
Onions. Onions, because they can go with everything. Peppers can't go with everything.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a great answer, because when we first saw that question, I was like, oh, I love peppers so much, but onions are everywhere.
Yeah.
Okay. Would you rather be at a live shoot? Okay, you have to pick one of these two. A live shoot in the audience at I Love Lucy or Julia Child's The French Chef?
Oh, that's tough. They're both funny. I would say probably I Love Lucy, only because I'm a big fan of hers. I mean, I love Julia too, but
yeah,
I can get out of my cooking zone when I'm watching I Love Lucy. You know, when I'm watching Julia, you know, there's a lot of that stuff is so familiar. You know what I mean? So this is different.
Totally. Great answer.
Yeah.
So you're throwing a dinner party. What music's in the background? Classical music or party music? And by party music, any type of party music to you?
Johnny Cash.
That's a great
love story. Johnny Cash. I can cook to Johnny Cash.
Okay, I before I even get to my question, that just blew my mind. I also love Johnny Cash. And though I love, you made a joke to us once, like we should make a show about throwing a divorce party or something.
Yes.
You always have these awesome curveballs. Like, I was not expecting Johnny Cash to be the answer to that question.
Well,
that was great. Okay, what do you have more fun making, Christmas Eve dinner or Easter dinner?
Oh, Christmas Eve, for
like,
sure.
No question.
No question. You know, it's because I love the Easter Bunny, but Santa is so much more fun. And, you know, and I can go all out and my family is here. And at Easter time, not everybody is here. And Christmas for sure. And I live in New England. So, you know, the snow and all that stuff.
Beautiful. Know. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Great answer.
Now, I assume that obviously you teach a lot. You teach, you know, taught high school cooking classes. You're still teaching through your show. So would you rather, do you enjoy now teaching cooking or taking cooking classes?
Oh, I enjoy teaching cooking. I enjoy teaching cooking classes. Yeah, I teach them, I do a lot of cooking classes everywhere. Boston University, I do them as special events for people. I just love walking into a room and being with people and just having fun with them. You know, I walk around and I show them certain things, and if I sense they feel a little intimidated or something, I try to make them feel comfortable, you know, and I tell them stories about stupid things I've done in cooking, you know, it just makes them laugh. So I really enjoy teaching.
Have you ever taught children cooking classes?
Yes, I did. When I think it was my second or third cookbook came out, I had a recipe in there for little bears made with a sweet yeast dough. So I went to a middle school, and before I got there, a week before, I told the teacher, I'm sending the recipe for making the little bears, and I want the mothers or the whoever their, you know, parent was to make the dough the day before I was to come. And when I came, we were in the big auditorium, the big long tables, and I showed these kids how to make the little bears. You can find the little bears on our website. They had the most fun because each bear was different because of the way they, you know, put it together and the word where they put the eyes and the nose and the little belly buttons. And they just had a blast and they learned how to, you know, how to make dough. It was so much fun.
I mean, I'm having so much fun right now. And before we wrap it up, is there anything you want to share with the audience, Marianne? Anything you want to tell them to do or any last?
Well, I would like them to just have fun cooking from my cookbooks. Go to our website and you can find so many videos there over the years that we've done. We have a foundation where we have scholarships for culinary students. We've given scholarships all over the U.S. for people who want to pursue a career in cooking. And so if they would go to that foundation site, they can see what we're all about. They would like to make a donation there. It would be wonderful. And I just want them to enjoy food and not feel trapped or intimidated and not worry about making mistakes. Believe me, I've made all of them, even winding up in the emergency room with first degree burns, trying to make oatmeal cookies for my husband once, but burning down the kitchen stove. So I've improved since then, but yeah, just have fun. And you know what? This has been so much fun. We should do this again.
This is awesome.
We should. I'm so inspired and motivated. So all you people out there watching the after party, get her cookbooks. You've seen her on TV. Keep watching stuff from her website, give to her foundation. And thanks, Marianne, for giving of your time and giving so much of your energy and heart to all of us in the world. You are the godmother of television cooking shows, and we're glad to be somewhere, somehow, way down the way, even remotely connected to you. So thank you so much for your time, my friend.
You're welcome. I wish you were the goddess, though. Ciao, ciao.